Hello everyone, it's Mike. Welcome back to my shop. I apologize, it's been a little while since I've made a video. I've been really kind of swamped here in the shop the last couple months. Nothing really exciting, just general repair type stuff, so I didn't think it was worth boring everybody with the same videos that everybody else has out there of standard routine repair jobs. So I've got a little bit of a unique interesting job here going on off my coach, so I thought maybe I'd just go ahead and make a video real quick. So I'll go ahead and bring you in closer. But what this is the Webasto burner out of the AquaHot system on our 2003 Monaco Dynasty motor coach. We a couple months on the previous segment, I had showed the general routine maintenance of changing the filter, the nozzle, a fuel solenoid panel because I was getting a little bit of smoking. Over the course of the summer, the smoking hasn't really changed, so it smokes initially. When you first fire it up, there's about a 45 second to a minute gap, and then it'll puff just a little bit of white smoke for approximately a minute, and then it cleans up and it's crystal clear the rest of the 15-20 minute burn cycle. So I've been stumped by this, because generally speaking on these, if they get a little bit of white smoke on startup, it's usually the fuel solenoid not shutting off all the way, so it pools a little bit of fuel. However, I noticed when I was doing some work on it the other, probably four or five weeks ago, I noticed I had a little dampness around my air intake, where there's a little bit of diesel fuel. And on this half is all the blower housing, so there should be no fuel on this side anyway. The fuel pump is up here, and here's your nozzle that sprays into the combustion chamber. So for quite a while now, I've been kind of suspecting a leaky fuel pump. This is the new style fuel pump that AquaHot has. It's quite a bit better than the old style as far as leaks, from what I'm told, but it is prone to leaks. So my thinking is, and that's why I pulled it out to tear it apart, my thinking is down underneath in the blower housing, where the input, where the shaft that drives the fuel pump is driven off the blower housing, off the motor, I think that it might be leaking a little bit there, pooling a little bit, because I've gotten a few, when I opened it up today even, the bottom of these two fittings were damp. So I think maybe what's happening is it's pooling a little bit in there, it fires up, takes a second to take that fuel from the blower housing to blow it in the combustion chamber, hence the kind of 45 second to a minute delay there. It smokes until it burns that off, but yet the fuel pump's not leaking enough to get a continual white smoke, which is usually indicative of a leaky fuel pump. So this is kind of a weird situation. This has had me kind of scratching my head a little bit. So we're going to tear it down, see if we can see where it's leaking in there. I'll get parts ordered from Roger Burke. He's very, very knowledgeable on the AquaHot. He's a fellow RVer, so I kind of want to make sure and support Roger in purchasing. Anybody who has one of these, I highly recommend purchasing their parts from him. He's an RVer. He travels around full time, but he works on these at rallies and so forth. He carries all the stock in his trailer. Very, very quick service as far as parts. When you place an order, if I place an order within 2 days, generally, depending on where he's at in the country, he'll have the parts to you. So that's kind of my little plug for Roger. He's a few times I've talked to him personally on the phone. He's been very helpful, very responsive. He has a forum also where you can go on and ask questions and so forth. But I'm not one to. He does have a service where you can send these burners to him and he'll rebuild them and send them back to you. I think it's a great service. Personally, I'm gonna figure this out. I'm a mechanic. I'm gonna figure this thing out come hell or high water. So I'll move you in closer with the camera and come along with me and see if we can find out where I got a fuel leak in here. Okay, again, let me give you a quick rundown of this real quick now that I've zoomed in here. Here you have your electrodes that spark. This on top here is your igniter coil. High voltage wires that come up here and spark across it. Here's your fuel solenoid. This is this floating disc here. This is supposed to float. This is when you put this in, this seals up against the combustion chamber. So you want this to float. You want it flat. You don't want it bent. Over on this side is your photo sensor. So this senses the flame fairly rapidly, so when that happens it shuts the igniters off but keeps fuel pump going. Here's your fuel pump. This is the air intake. Here's your two fuel lines. You've got your supply line coming in here. Also, you can see down in here, this is where you set the fuel pressure. Over on this side is the return. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and pull these lines off, pull this top, this disc off, and the nozzle itself, the igniters, the fuel solenoid, and then I'm going to pull these, four screws to pull this inside disc up, and that will pretty much separate it from the blower housing. So that'll be this side is the combustion chamber side, this side is the blower housing. So this is just a plastic or composite housing. So we'll go ahead and start tearing it down and see if we can see where our fuel leak's coming from. All right, so you want to take a little screwdriver and work up and get this little snap ring off that holds this floating photocell disc on. Just set that aside. Then you want to take a 10 millimeter, and on this other side over here is a clamp that holds the electrodes. Now in my last video I showed where you pull the little side gauge off and set the distance on these electrodes in relation to the nozzle. Now that I've disturbed that, that's going to be something we're going to do again. So I will show that again. It might be a little easier to see because I'll actually show it here on the workbench. So now I'm just pulling my electrodes out of the way, like so. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and just take this clamp out of the way because I'm going to pull that stand out as well. So let me go ahead and pull that. Now let's pull the wiring off for the fuel solenoid. There's an 8 millimeter nut on the back side over here. Just loosen that up and take that nut off. I'm going to see if I can get all the electrical here out of the way for starters, and then we'll proceed from there. So there's the nut off the solenoid. Should be a washer there. Yep, there's a flat washer. I'll just tip that up. And there is a brown wire and then a white wire. Best thing to do on these is you need to take a screwdriver and use the fuel solenoid there as a fulcrum and just press that clip off. That way you're not actually pulling on the wire and pull the wire out of the connector. So brown one goes on top, which is your ground. And then there's the white that goes to the photocell and the wiring harness there. I'm just go ahead and pull that wiring harness out of the way. Go ahead and pull these igniters out of the way. And I'm actually going to go ahead and pull this coil off the back side here real quick, just so I can get these igniters set aside out of the way. Less chance of damaging them. They are in good shape, they're clean. Coach is, it's an 03, so it is 12, technically 13 years old, because I'm sure it was built in 02, being an 03 model. And so it has, this AquaHot is one of the must-haves when I was looking, my wife and I was looking for the coach. This was one of those things we absolutely wanted. It's been fairly trouble-free. Had a couple instances when we first bought it, which is one of the reasons why I think the previous owners had traded it in. But once we got it working, it's been working pretty trouble-free. But we just experiencing a few issues this off and on during this season. So, okay, I've got those out of the way. Go ahead and pull this coil out of the way. And I'm going to then pull the fuel lines. On these there's a banjo bolt. So you have a banjo bolt, washer, the banjo fitting itself, another crush washer, same on the other side, on the supply side. So I'll loosen those and go ahead and pull up these rubber boots. The two rubber boots, well, it might not be a bad idea to replace these rubber boots. The rubber boots are a little hard, not bad, but they can be a source. You want to have this sealed so it sucks air in through the intake and blows through here. And if you have air leaks around these fittings, it can affect combustion. So it's not as bad as on a gasoline engine you're running lean, but you just want to make sure that it's pulling air through the air intake here rather than through the housing here. So they're a little hard, they're not really pliable, so I may just go ahead and replace those while I'm at it. So let me go ahead and pull this disc up and pull this housing apart while I'm right here. It looks like that is a metric, I'm guessing probably maybe a 3. Not bigger than that. Bigger than that. 4 millimeter, there we go. So let's go ahead and pull these routines. These are a socket, metric socket head cap screw. And once I pull this up, it should disengage the fuel pump gear with the blower housing gear. And I'm pretty confident that once I get this torn apart, I'm going to replace the bearings on the blower housing, on the blower shaft. Namely because when you start seeing fuel leaking out of the intake like that, that tells you that there's a leak on this side, on the blower housing side of this assembly. Well, there's nothing on that side. All the business end of for fuel system is all on the combustion chamber side of this housing. The only thing that sticks on that side is the input shaft for the fuel pump. So I'm assuming that's the only place this can really be leaking from. That being said, if fuel's in there, it can get on the bearings, wash the lubrication out of the bearings, and these spin at, I believe, 43 to 4,500 RPM. So that's quite a bit of RPM, and you don't want that lubrication washed out of there. So they do make a bearing kit. I did see that on Roger's parts breakdown. So more than likely, while I'm in there, I'm in this deep, I'm probably just going to go ahead. You can see, even just sitting here, it's dripping fuel. It's dripping fuel out of that intake right while it's just sitting here on the bench onto my mat. So that's not supposed to happen. So I think we definitely have fuel pump leaks, the issues on that side. We'll see if I'm right when I get this apart. So I'm going to take and just pry up very, ever so slightly. You can just get underneath one of these banjo bolts and lift it up a little. There, pop loose, nice and easy. So then the fittings and everything come right up. And before anything damage can happen, I'm going to pull that fuel solenoid off, set it aside. There is the, you can see the underside here, and it's all damp with fuel. There's the gear that drives off of, let's see if you can see this, excuse me. Here's the driven gear coming off the blower housing. It has a grease or lubrication in there. It looks kind of, yeah, it's actually pretty, not, doesn't look like it's a greaser grease right now. It looks like a crumbly paste, so that's definitely going to get re-lubricated. That's pretty nasty looking grease there. Throw that in the garbage before I get that all over. Yeah, that grease is coming out of there in chunks. So yeah, we're definitely going to go through and rebuild this while we're right here on the bench. So we'll see what, actually I'm going to go ahead while we're sitting right here, I'm going to go ahead and pull that snap ring off and let's take a look right away at that fuel pump. Okay, snap ring off. And very ever so carefully
There we go. We got that hard grease is just coming out of there in chunks. Look at that. That is definitely not good. So get that up off of there. Clean the gear up. Set it aside. And yep, you can look. I think that's my leak because that is coated with diesel on that side of the pump. You look, you see, hope this is showing up on the video, but you can see the fuel, the diesel fuel running down. When I tip that, you can see it's pooling down in there by the snap ring. Yep, this is definitely leaking. So I'm gonna pull this apart, give it a good cleaning here real quick, because you don't necessarily need to see that. And then probably, yeah, look at all that. That's the grease. So I'm gonna pull it apart here and kind of make a list to see about some parts that I'm gonna need. I'm guessing at least a fuel pump. And at least a fuel pump. One other thing I wanted to mention that I have seen before is this is what they call the nozzle stand, because obviously the nozzle threads into the end here. This is where the fuel solenoid goes in. Where this fuel solenoid goes in, I actually saved the parts. Boy, that thing's just got diesel all over the place. I think I referenced this in the last video where I serviced the AquaHot, where I showed the where the had been sealing against the seat in that stand. That can actually be a place of wear, so I'm going to take a close look at that. Where I'm into it this far, I may just, and where it's got some age on it, I may just go ahead and replace that this stand, dependent on what I see when I pull this apart, what that seat looks like. That's a lot of, every time that fuel solenoid opens and closes, it's hammering away at that seat. So I replace the serviceable part, but if that seat's damaged, or it doesn't even look, if it looks questionable at all, I'm going to go ahead and replace this stand. So I'm going to go ahead and pull this down, pull the fittings off, and clean things up, and then I'll make a list, and I'll bring you back in when I get to that point. All right, quick shot here. I got the blower housing removed. There's a O-ring right here that seals the blower housing, but you can see, I hope this shows up, but you can see all the fuel. Let me get to catch the light. You can see all the fuel that's on the blower housing side. Here's the plate. There's the lines, where there's the openings where the fuel lines and the wiring went through. This is all on the blower housing side. Even back here on the motor, there's a little residue, but this fuel is all back here. So I'm fairly confident that fuel pump shaft's leaking, and that's what's getting fuel on this side. Again, my theory is it's pooling a little bit, and then the air coming in from back here, blowing through, is carrying some of that fuel through and intermittently burning it in the combustion chamber. So look, just while I had it sitting here turned over here, that's how much fuel is just puddled right there. That's already been on the housing, and it's just running down and collecting. So I'm gonna go ahead and make a list of some parts and get this thing cleaned up, and then we'll go to reassembly. All right, I thought I'd go ahead and show you how I'm getting the bearings out of here. There's a little sleeve down in there, so I'm just very lightly tapping. Boom, there's the bearing. And holy cow, look at that. I don't know if that'll show up or not. Look at that fuel on the bearing. So, probably a good thing I pulled it down this far. So, there's the other bearing. This one's going to be the one furthest away, and it's got a little fuel on it as well. This is the one closest to the motor. The one I just showed you was the one closest to the fuel pump, and it does have quite a bit of fuel on it. So good thing we pulled that apart. So I'm gonna clean this in the solvent tank, pull this O-ring off of here so I don't oh, look at that O-ring. Well, better add that to the parts list. That O-ring's seen better days. So that's definitely gonna be replaced. And then I've got a waver washer and a snap ring here. So I'm gonna go ahead and throw these in the solvent tank, clean them all up nice. And there's the other part of the housing. The inside of that part was dry. So like I say, it wasn't smoking that bad, and it was just you just barely faintly see the white smoke. So it wasn't real bad, but it was bad enough to bug the hell out of me. So if anything, it was embarrassing. I hate things on my vehicles. I don't like them when they're not just right. So I'm sure there's a lot of you out there that can probably relate. So most people probably would have lived with this a little bit longer, but the last couple months has been driving me up a wall because I couldn't get time to find it. When I did have a few minutes, I didn't quite have enough time to dig this deep into it, that I kind of had a feeling I was going to have to dig into it this deep to find the actual problem. So I think I found it. I feel good about it. I'll go through and clean everything, get some parts coming, and reassembly. All right, Roger come through again. Roger Burke, RV, Hydronic RV, I think is what it is, RV Hydronics Forum. Can't remember. I'll put a link to it in my video there. There's the bearings. There's the nice pliable O-ring versus the hard and brittle one. So let's go ahead and put the bearings in. Oh, it also comes with a new nylock nut for on the drive gear that engages with the fuel pump, so that will be a nice new nut on there, so it won't back off. You should always nylocks, although a lot of people, myself included, reuse them a time or two here on critical items. You should not reuse nylocks. So let me just go out there and say that. Another bearing. Just press down. I'm just gonna take the end of my down in there nice and neat. Wave washer goes in, and last but not least here is the snap ring. And you notice it did not snap. Goes down on that wave washer, so you put a little bit of walk around it, put a little bit of tension on down on that wave washer and make sure you get full engagement with that snap ring, that retaining ring, into the groove. So that's a done deal there. Now I can go ahead and put my actually I gotta line up. You can see, hopefully this will show up. You can see where that little spacer in there isn't quite lined up. So I'm just gonna run a punch in there and line that up. And there is a couple of washers. And these are a Belleville washer. Some people call these wave washers, but these are technically called a Belleville washer. And what these are is two washers with the convex side touching, concaves opposite. So as you tighten them down, they flatten out. So you want to make sure those are on there correctly. Go ahead and slide that down in. Nice and smooth. What we'll end up doing, what you do on these, is that Belleville washer is on the in between this plastic housing and the aluminum housing. So if you tighten this nut down, you'll tighten it off till, because you can actually compress. It might be hard to see that gap there, but I can actually push down and eliminate that gap. So you want to tighten the nylock down till basically that you almost hear it dragging, and then back it off. And I will look at the specs and see how far you back it off. I think it's a quarter or half a turn, I can't remember which. So I'm gonna go ahead and look at that before I put this gear and everything back on. All right, gear's cleaned. I've inspected the teeth. Also inspected the teeth on the plastic one. Everything, nothing's broken. They don't look worn. Nice sharp crisp edges, so I know they're mating correctly. I have not cleaned the plastic gear yet, I will. But there's the, it looks like a bronze gear. So got all that nasty hard lubricant off of there. Now there is a little brass washer here. Looks like it's probably, I don't know, 70 thousandths or 60 thousandths. That goes on first, down underneath the gear, onto the shaft. Then you go ahead and put the bronze gear on, and the shaft's got two flats on it, so the gear will only go on one way. So that drops down on. Then our new nylock goes on there. And that's a 10 millimeter. Clean that old nasty grease off my socket, and I'll transfer that back onto all of our nice clean parts. So run this down. And I was right on the spec, you tighten it down until it just makes contact. Hear that? Just makes contact. It still turns, but it's just lightly scrubbing. And then you back it off a quarter of a turn. So bingo. Smooth as can be. Okay, there's that part done. Now I'm going to go ahead and put the little coupler on for the motor. Give that a little bit of a cleaning. And it just goes down, looks like it just goes down until it stops. Oh yeah, it's just got a stop machine on the shaft, so that's just going to go down until it stops. Okay, here he's still spinning freely. So I'm going to go ahead and put the motor back on. Now, one thing I did when I was doing this was, oh whoops, you know what? Forgot to put the other part of the housing on. The other part of the housing's got to go on. Now, that's what I was leading up to. I don't know if you can see that, I put two pins right there. This looks symmetrical, but I don't know if all the years of in the industrial industry, I don't know, but sometimes things look perfectly symmetrical and they're not, so I just usually get in the habit of, I just usually use a little spring-loaded center punch, put a couple of pins on it, line everything back up, going back together. Now one thing I did notice was that there was no torque spec on these, on this particular housing. On aluminum housings like this, that doesn't really thrill me, so I'm going to go ahead and get my little inch pound torque wrench out, and I am going to torque that anyway. Inch pounds here, and I'm going to set it to just about 40. See how that goes. I just wanted to be consistent. You got a plastic housing in there floating around, spinning around, and I don't want to distort it. So, like I said, I did not find a torque spec on it, but I am going to torque it anyway. that's torqued down in place. I think I ended up at 46
inch pounds. So just nice and uniform across the board there.
And I'm going to spin this, put this, now put the coupler on. Spins nice and free. And I did the same thing on the motor, where the motor joins onto this. I put a little peen mark right there. So now I just take this, and there's my peen. So I'll mesh the coupler. My peen mark there. Three socket head cap screws. Make sure you don't pinch any wires underneath there. You know what, I'm gonna
torque that one as well.
Run them down, torque them as well. Technically now I can go ahead and put the O-ring on and the dummy. Should have put the blower, the O-ring on before I did all the wiring. So now I gotta sneak all the wiring through the O-ring. Oh well. Not the end of the world. So sneak all the wiring through. And then I'm going to put just a little bit of Sil Glide around this O-ring to help that blower housing sit down on there. Get that out of the way. Like I said, I might as well just go ahead and put this back together, put the housing and everything on to protect all of this rather than having it sitting here. Then I'll move on to the fuel pump, side of things. So again, I just use just some Sil Glide, just a silicone paste. Okay, so now we're going to work on the fuel side of things here. So I popped the little grommets off and they are pretty hard, not very pliable. So I've got new ones here. Come in my kit from, well, not my kit, but in the package of parts I ordered from Roger. So they much more pliable. So those will come off. Gonna go ahead and break our fittings loose here. We've got, like I said, we've got our supply and our return. Supply's got to have this little hickey in the tube because it's got to make room for the adjustment for the fuel pressure, which I'll have to check and reset again after I'm done here. So again, you're going to have a crush washer, banjo bolt, banjo fitting, another crush washer. And in the fuel pump, actually, these do come with, Roger does put these together in kit form. So with the fuel pump, I'll show you here in a moment. So same thing on the return side. You've got a crush sleeve, you got the banjo bolt, crush sleeve, banjo fitting, crush sleeve, and into the pump. So let me go ahead and show you the new pump assembly here. Here's the new pump assembly. And in the package of goodies, besides the new pump, oh, actually, it's got a different form. Looks like it has a Torx instead of the, see if I can show you here. Instead of the flat-bladed screwdriver, it actually has a Torx. So there's the fuel pump. Also comes a new line that goes from the fuel pump to the stand. The long side goes into the fuel pump, the short end goes into the stand. So there's that. And then there are new banjo bolts and crushleys. And I'm actually going to leave them in the baggie here momentarily just so I don't get them mixed up. So these are, this fitting over here is an 8mm. So go ahead and crack that loose. Now on the old style pumps, they look a little different here, and there's a standoff in order to space it out. Those can get pretty nasty and grungy trying to get apart, so if you need to break the, or cut rather, the tube in order to get those out, don't worry about it, because there's a new one that comes in with a fuel pump, at least if there is, if you buy them from Roger Burke. So there's the fitting there. Leave the old parts here. So now I can actually go ahead, and there's two, those look like probably 3mm. Yes, they are. There's 2 3mm bolts there. So we'll go ahead and pull those out. The bolts will be reused, the socket head bolts, because they are not, there's no new ones of those that come in the, with the fuel pump. So there we go. I think that's the one that's causing us the leakitis right there. So set that aside. And I am going to go one step further since I'm right here. I believe that's a 16mm. I'm going to go ahead and pull that out. So I'm going to go ahead and pop this loose from the stand here. Yep. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and pull this part out. This is the one I replaced the rebuild kit in. And these can occasionally, from what Roger told me, and Roger was actually awesome, he included one of these with the parts, because he said that these can sometimes bend. I felt pretty good about this one when I did it, when I did it the first time. There was no adverse, I mean, it doesn't drag, there's no sticking or anything, so I'm going to go ahead and reuse mine, because it's nice and straight, square, and also I put the new plunger kit in there, so I'm going to reuse mine. So now I am going to, and to be honest with you, if I look at the stand, my stand versus a new one, there is a slight, it's ever so slight, and I don't even know if it'll show up on camera, but there is, see how much more pointed or more slimline this one is. The land where we're looking at is right here. This area right there is a lot more consistent and narrow at that land, so when that plunger goes in there to seat, it's going to seat more firmly on this new one. Even though I don't feel like there's anything wrong with mine, it is a little broader, so it does have some years. It's 13 years with the year use. And I know I've used it quite heavily. We've used our motor coach for snowmobiling up until we sold our sleds. We usually start using it about February through November here in northern Utah, so it does get cold, and we're using our AquaHot. There's some people that are fair weather RVers. I would prefer fair weather RVing, but it's not the case, and so we start usually using it around February, and it's nothing to go out in 15-20 degree weather, and go out for a weekend or a getaway on President's Weekend or so forth up in the mountains and relax, watch it snow, do whatever. Like I said, we used to snowmobile, but seems like we don't snowmobile anymore. But the point is, the AquaHot gets used a lot. So I am going to go ahead and replace this stand on mine. I ordered one. I'm into it, all these parts. I think the stand was another $220 or something. I'm still into all these parts. Everything I'm replacing here, less than $700. And I think a remand one of these units is $3,500, I believe, I saw on the internet. And they're just a mechanical component. That's why I wanted to go ahead and do it myself. I'm a mechanic by trade, so if I can't do this, I probably ought to sell my tools and hang it up. So anyway, I'm going to go ahead and clean up these parts, pull this stand off, and then I'll come back and show you as we're assembling it. All right, plate cleaned up, ready to go back together. So first thing is I'm going to put the new stand into place. The clamp part goes away from the hole here, so I'll go ahead and start that, tighten this down. Screws are a little tight going in, but that's a good thing. You don't want this coming apart or loosening up. Okay, stand installed. Now, again, I'm going to go ahead and put my plunger, and this is all a new plunger and new O-ring, two, maybe 3 months ago is all, so I'm going to go ahead and assemble that. And again, it's 16 millimeter deep socket. Okay. And it doesn't need to be, it needs to be tight, but not, it's got no ring in there. That's what's actually sealing it. Okay, so now that I've got that on, I'm going to go ahead and put the fuel pump down into place. So set that loosely down into place. I'm going to say loosely because now I'm going to take the new line here and start it before I put the screws in for the fuel pump. So go ahead and run them in just finger tight. Sorry, this might be a little off camera here. I'm just going to snug them down and then back them off a little bit just to make sure they're all the way in. Then, so I'm going to leave these loose. Back that off about a half, three quarters of a turn. Same thing on the top one. Just run it in until it lightly seats and back it off a half a turn or so. Okay. Now my socket head cap screws that hold the fuel pump to the base plate here, and that way if you have to tweak it or rotate, I just gotta move it there ever so slightly to get that to start. And that one started as well. Tighten I'm going to go ahead and tighten the fuel pump down to the base plate now. Okay. Then, before you forget, go ahead and tighten down the pipe between the stand and the fuel pump, the high pressure line. These you want to make sure are tight because there's a lot of pressure coming out of this fuel pump going to, because once this goes in here and that solenoid opens, it's coming right to that nozzle, and that nozzle is only a 0.35 gallons per hour orifice. So it's not a very big orifice. So you get a super fine atomization of the fuel, so that when that ignites across it, you get a good clean burn. So that's all installed now, nice and tight. That's done. So now I can actually go ahead and put the gear on the bottom, put this back in, and start putting my wiring and everything together. Oh, one other thing I want to do here first. I put the old banjo bolts and washers, crush washers aside, so I'm going to go ahead and dump these ones out now. So there's one bolt, crush washer. I heard it hit. I think I dropped my crush washer here under my mat. Alright, there's my other one right there. So, had me scared there for a second. It bounced the one under my screwdriver. So now we've got a banjo bolt, crush sleeve, and there's one that's a waver. And I can't remember. Let me look through here and see which one's which. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and put the banjo bolt, crush sleeve, banjo bolt, crush sleeve. And start it onto the fuel pump. And just start it is all. Then we come around to the other side on the return line. Banjo bolt, crush sleeve, banjo fitting, crush sleeve. And start that one on the return side. Okay, leave them lightly loose there. Now I'm going to go ahead and figure out which one of my grommets go to which. There's a left and a right on these grommets. So you want to make sure and put the left one on the left side, the right one on the right side. And these ones are actually not cut, so we grab a little X-Acto knife. So you have a left and a right, but these ones are actually blank, so you just cut them accordingly. So let me make sure and get, so that one's the left side, and the right side. Boom. Okay, so as that goes on, this is going to be, so I'm going to just make a little cut. If you kind of squeeze them, you can kind of see. Just cut a little hole about the size. Of the line itself. Bingo. So that one will go, actually it goes upwards like so. Now a nice snug fit on the line there. So here's the other one. Like I said, just gonna squeeze it and you can actually kinda work your way around. There's the other one. Okay, there's that. Now, I'm actually going to go ahead and set this fuel solenoid in place, because when this plate drops down in this housing, you can't get the fuel solenoid on and off there. So I'm going to go ahead and set that down into place. I'm not going to tighten it all the way, but I am going to put the washer and the Nylock nut on there and start it. So I'm going to go ahead and readjust the camera so you can see this going in. Okay, so before I do that, want to make sure you want to make sure and put your plastic gear on, and also the little snap ring. Now I went ahead and actually bought a new snap ring for that. For I can't remember how much it was. It was dirt cheap, but I figured rather than digging through trying to find the right size, Roger had these all sorted out. So let's just go ahead and get the right one. So I put a new one on, holding that fuel pump gear on. And bingo, that gear's on. Okay, now we're going to want to put some of this new lube that Roger sent us. Let me go ahead and readjust again here. So there's a little plastic, just some high temperature grease. So you want to put it around the bronze gear here. It's coming through that we tightened the nut on earlier. And then you want to put it about three or four places around the plastic gear. So when it's running, it'll smear that around. So I'm going to go ahead and utilize the lube accordingly. So I'm just gonna squeeze it out of the tube, out of the Ziploc bag here. Put it down on the gear, turn the gear. I don't know if there's really any pretty way of putting this lube on. I'm just going to take, squeeze it out of the plastic baggie and just kind of pack it down into the teeth on the gear so it coats nice and uniformly. When I pulled it apart, all that nasty hard crunchy crap that come out, I'm sure was this same stuff, only with 13 years on it. So pack this all down in, make sure that gear is properly coated. And like I said, about three or four locations. Around the plastic gear. The drive, this is actually the drive gear for the fuel pump. does no good to get it up on top of the gear. That's not where the gears are meshing. So, get that all packed down and around there. Clean out my Ziploc baggie here of it. Clean it all off my screwdriver, get as much as I can off and into the teeth of the plastic gear. Thought it'd be nice and quiet, because boy, there wasn't anything on there that was even in place when I pulled it apart. So now that I've got packed down in there on the teeth, I'm gonna go ahead and set it down into place. Now this is where you want to be careful, because you're meshing this plastic gear with this bronze gear. So as you set it down in, if it doesn't fit and drop all the way down, don't force it, because it's plastic gear. Take it out, turn it tooth or half a tooth, boom, just like that. It'll drop right in as those teeth mesh, and then you can go ahead and set your fittings down in, because you haven't tightened them yet. At least you shouldn't have tightened them yet. That one actually tightened up a little bit more than it should have. So push it down in. So at this point, you don't want to tighten these yet. What you want to do is you want to actually get that down in there. This is all done. So now I'm going to go ahead and put these socket head cap screws back down in. Should be four of these that run around holding the plate in. Now if you haven't put your solenoid on, you want to do this before this plate goes down in, because its solenoid sits down below this base and you will not get that solenoid on there. So run these down and start them. Make sure they all start nice and easily. Get them into place and then start snugging them down. And like I said, you do not want to, worst case scenarios, you do not want to, if this plate isn't all the way down, thinking, well, I'll suck it down with these bolts. Because if it's not all the way down, it sits down in there pretty easily. If it's not all the way down in there before you even start putting the bolts in, it's because that plastic gear is not meshed with that bronze gear. You want to make sure those are meshed, this plate is all the way down in, before you even think about putting those screws in, or you will break that plastic gear. Guaranteed. Okay, and I'm going to go one step further here and just spin my impeller and just make sure it's turning it freely. Everything's good. Run around this. I'm going to put a torque wrench on that real quick. Torque that like I've torqued the other ones. Actually, I'm going to back these off a little bit. I've got them tighter than what my had my torque wrench set for, so that's not good. They're probably tight, they're probably fine, but I know they probably weren't consistent. At least not as consistent as with a torque wrench. And when you've been wrenching a long time, you get a feel for when you have bolts consistent. I'm fairly good at that, but I've been wrenching a long time, and there's no way I can set my arm to 45 inch pounds and come as close as I can with a torque wrench. So I've been wrenching for well over 30 years now, and I'm not quite that good yet, so I guess I need some more practice. But good old torque wrench, that's what they're for. Okay, that part's done. Now that's all done, you can hold down on this. You want to make sure that you seal that up as well as you can on that banjo bolt and that fitting. Push down on that rubber, because this is going to be seated up against the combustion chamber. So you want to seat down in there. You don't want any gap Now you're going to want to go ahead and tighten these banjo fittings. So that seals nice and snug around it. There's the other one. Okay. Perfect. Now, before I forget also, there's two different style fittings. The old style come off of these banjo bolts, come over here, and they just have a barb. So these are much better, these unions. They have a just a JIC fitting here, and they're just much more precise. So once we get that done, we can go ahead and start assembling the electrodes, the photocell, and go from there. Okay, standing this back up here now, we are on the home stretch. So we're going to take the photo disc here. We're going to put the electrodes up through the photo disc, set it down into place, take our clamp that we took off earlier and put it in place, and just finger tight, snug. You know what? That clamp has a little bit of dirt residue or film on it. All this cleaning of all these parts, getting everything cleaned and beautiful to go into a basement compartment that'll never be seen, is a bit senseless. So let's go ahead and clean that clamp up so it matches everything else. So now we go ahead and tighten that down finger tight. Then we are going to go ahead and put our nozzle back down into place. Tighten these, take a 3/4 inch wrench and a 5/8, and you tighten it, then you back it off just a little bit, quarter, and then you tighten it again. That allows those two tapers on the stand, and then the taper on the nozzle, to sit down and snug nice and tight. So, almost forgot the clip. And there again, I also ordered a new clip, retaining clip, for this floating photocell disc here. So we're just going to take and go down over a flat, and just very little pressure. You don't want to open that up. You don't want to stretch it, make it any wider than it is. You just want to just go down onto a flat on the stand there. Just slowly walk that clip around. And then push it down on, boom, snaps down on tight, and that disc is supposed to float, remember. So now that we have that done, we take our handy dandy, almost lost the screw, we take our handy dandy little gauge that you saw in the last video, you slide it down onto the stand, all the way down till it, and it goes all the way down till this part touches on top of the nozzle. That's where it stops. Now at that point, let's see if I'm going to make sure this is being seen in the video. I'm going to zoom in on this. I don't know how much I zoomed in on it when I adjusted it before. So again, this gauge sits down over the stand and rests right on top of the nozzle. So just kind of push down on it, make sure it's down on the nozzle. Then the two electrodes are going to sit . You want to make sure they fit right up in the little points right there. So there's one, there's the other one, and then 10 millimeter socket to make sure those are down in there perfectly. Snug that down, and you do not want to tighten this real tight because it's just a little bracket. It will bend and or break the insulators on your nozzle, on your electrodes. So they're down, they're into the points, nice and snugly there, if that's a technical term. So just lightly snug that. Go ahead and pull your gauge off. It's set, it's adjusted. Don't forget to put your gauge back on the side of your housing, because it's also one of the screws that hold the blower housing. To the aluminum housing, the aluminum part. So that's snugged down in place. You can buy those gauges separately, but there's no sense in it, because if you just make sure that it's there when you need it, then there's no sense in having to hunt one down. So now, last two little items. You want to make sure your wires are all situated for your electrodes, that they are situated properly into the rubber grommet, and the rubber grommet sits in there. I put the coil back on, then you want to make sure this other one is, and the wires are connected from the harness onto your solenoid, which both of those are. Now once they're on, you can go ahead and rotate that down just a slight little bit. I'm actually going to tuck the wires down underneath the solenoid, and then on the other side over here, I like to tuck the wires under the photo, the disc here. That kind of helps protect it a little bit from the combustion chamber, from the heat. So we'll go ahead and tighten this nut on the solenoid. Wiring harness is done. And there is one freshly rebuilt, ready to install Webasto burner for an AquaHot heating system. Back that away, and you can kind of see how it cleaned up very nice. And more importantly, I think I got my fuel leak fixed. So now tomorrow I can go ahead and hook up my fuel lines, run it through a purge the air out of the fuel system. Once I get that done, I will actually pull this nozzle back out, thread my I don't have it here, it's at the motorhome. Thread my pressure gauge in, set my fuel pressure to 145 PSI. I think you can go plus or minus 5 PSI on that, but you want to get pretty close to 145, as close as you can. Then it's ready to pull the fuel gauge out, put my nozzle back in, and ready to put this back in the coach and hook everything up, and she's ready to fire. So I hope you've enjoyed this. Hope it was informative. And I appreciate all the comments that everybody's made so far on my videos. So if you have any comments, questions, thoughts, feel free to leave them in the comment section below. And thanks for watching.